Also der nächste Referent darf ich ankündigen, Professor Dr. Nicolas Cafetta, auch kein Unbekannter hier. Darf ich, kann man nachher weitermachen? Ja, danke. Professor Cafetta ist Physiker und Professor für Ozeanographie und Atmosphärenphysik an der Universität Federico Dürr in Neapel. Er hat 2001 an der Universität North Texas in Denton promoviert. Und Professor Cafetta forscht zum Klimawandel, der Veränderung der Atmosphäre und den Ozeanen, den Zusammenhang zwischen Sonnenaktivität und dem Klima sowie anderen geophysischen Phänomenen. Sein Arbeitsgebiet erstreckt sich auf theoretische und angewandte Statistik und nonlineare Modelle komplexer Prozesse. Professor Cafetta veröffentlicht regelmäßig in einer Reihe von Fachgebieten wie Astronomie, Biologie, Klimatologie, Physik und Soziologie. Sein Thema heute sind die CMIP6, GCM und globale Oberflächentemperaturen, eine Diskussion über die Gleichgewichtsklimasensitivität. The floor is yours.
Ja. Yeah. So, do you hear me? Yes. Okay. Okay, so today my topic, I would like to thank you for inviting me, first of all. And I would like to talk about this topic. So I am going to talk about the global climate models and how they perform. Okay, so what are the open issues regarding the climate models? Because everything that we are talking about, including the alarmism, it derives from these climate models. So we need to understand these climate models for really understanding what is going on. Okay, so we need to discuss the models. And in particular, I would like to compare the performance of the global climate models against the global surface temperatures. And so we would like to validate to check whether or not the models are validated and or not validated. And we will discuss in particular the equilibrium climate sensitivity. What is the equilibrium climate sensitivity? Is how much the climate is sensitive to CO2. Okay, so because this is what we are talking about, no? That CO2 is changing climate, but the problem is to understand how much is changing the climate. And this is the parameter, the relevant parameter. So equilibrium climate sensitivity. So we will discuss all this stuff today. Now these are the global surface temperature. These are an estimate of global surface temperature. So this is the global warming. Since 1850 to now, the temperature has increased about 1 degree Celsius. So this is the global warming, as you see here. The global warming has not been regular, so there were periods of warming, little cooling, warming, another cooling, warming, and so on. So there is some cycle there. So this is the records, the global temperature records are interpreted using these global climate models that are very complex programs, so they need huge computers to do the calculation. Essentially, the atmosphere is divided in little cells, little boxes, and people try to simulate the global circulation of the atmosphere and the interaction with the atmosphere and the ocean. So they try to simulate the climate system using physical equations. So these are very complex models, but of course, inside the computers, one can put only the physics that is known. Okay, so nobody can put inside the computer a physics that is not known. Okay, something that is unknown about the climate system cannot be inserted inside the computer. So the computer practically produces some kind of ideal climate, a climate that is virtual climate. Okay, so it's a virtual reality, it's not the real one. So, but it may get close to reality, but we need to check it, whether or not the climate models are really able to simulate the climate system. Now, This is the picture, the scary picture because the climate models are used not only for trying to interpret the climate change between 1850 to now, but the same models are also used to do some kind of climate prediction. So they essentially, there are hypotheses that are called scenarios, different scenarios regarding the future emissions, and the climate models can be run using these hypotheses regarding the future emissions, and the models produce this kind of warming. So so these are different scenarios, and you get different kind of warming. Why this is the scaring picture? Because it's a scaring picture because then there are other models like, practically the idea is that if the warming increases too much, then there will be problems. Okay, so this picture here is actually a diagram of the hazards relating to global warming. So if the warming rise above 2 Celsius, then you start to have problems in several climate systems because you will not be able to adapt very easily. So usually people would like to adapt to climate change. The claim is that if the climate warms too much and too fast, we will not be able to adapt, so we need to mitigate climate change by reducing the emissions. And this is the limit, okay, so this 2 Celsius target limit by 250, so we would like, so the IPCC suggests that we keep the temperature below 2 Celsius degree. And the issue is that these climate models predict that by 2050 the temperature will be above 2 Celsius degree, and therefore there will be issues that cannot be addressed with the adaptation, so we need to mitigate climate change. So we need to reduce drastically the emission of CO2, okay? But what is the problem? The problem is that there are open issues regarding all this interpretation of climate change. The first issues are, can we trust the climate models? Because these models are the ones that are making this prediction, this very alarming prediction. So can we trust climate models? And there are issues here regarding the model validations, so are really validated. Issue regarding the equilibrium climate sensitivity, so how much is the sensitivity of the system to CO2 increase. Issues regarding the solar and other climate forcing, so are we using the right forcing or not? Okay. There are issues regarding the natural climate oscillations. Are these models able to reproduce the natural climate oscillation or not? So these are a very important issue. But these are, then we have a different kind of open issues. So can we trust the global surface temperature record? So essentially we have seen that according to several reconstructions, there has been a 1 degree Celsius warming since 1900, but it is true that indeed we need to question these things because there are open issues regarding the urban heat and other possible surface temperature contaminations, so there may be too much warming in those records, okay? So the real warming could be less. There are issues regarding the comparison between satellite surface measurements. They don't give the same results, so there are open issues there, so we need to understand why. There are issues regarding a comparison between instrumental and proxy temperature records. Also in this case, we observe that there is a discrepancy between what some reconstruction based on thermometer tell us and other reconstruction that based on proxy records like 3 rings tell us. They don't give us the same results. So we need to understand all these issues. They are all big issues. regarding climate models and regarding the global surface temperature that needs to be addressed. Now, let us try to understand very well what is the big problem that climate models have. Now, when people say that humans are responsible for 100% of the warming observed since 1900 to now, they actually are using this kind of argument. So practically what do? They use the climate models. The climate models are run in two different ways. In the first way, the climate models are run using only the natural forcings. So practically they use only the solar forcing and the volcano forcing, and they check what happens to the system, okay? So the climate models in this case produce this kind of red or blue lines, and you can see here that the climate model produces exactly the same temperature, okay? So the temperature here is equal to the temperature here, it is equal to the temperature here. So this means that according to these models, a natural variability would have not produced any warming whatever. Okay? So the climate should have been constant for more than 100 years, perfectly constant. Then sometimes there are some volcano eruption that reduce the temperature, but then the climate would essentially be constant. So there is no a real natural climate variability. So this is what the models are predicting. No? Natural climate variability is negligible. Because without humans, the climate would have been constant. Okay? Then the same models are run using natural and anthropogenic forcings. So they put inside the CO2 and so on. And now they say that the climate models agree with the black line, that is the line of the temperature records. By comparing these two pictures, the message is that the warming has been induced only by humans. So the IPCC, by using these models, claims that humans are responsible for 100% of the warming observed since 1900 to now. Okay, so that is the claim of that is made. So when we talk anthropogenic global warming, we mean that humans are responsible of 100% of the warming, not 80%, not 70%, 50%. 100%. So this is the claim, okay? This is the claim made by. Now, what is the problem with this argument? Why this argument does not work? Because there is a huge problem. The problem is that in science we need to validate the models, okay? So we need to check whether or not the models actually reconstruct the natural system. And in this, to do this, the scientific method requires that we need to compare the model prediction against the data, against the observations, and we need to demonstrate that the model predictions and the data agree. Okay, so this is what the scientific method tells us. So I have to do, the model says something, then I do an experiment, and I have to demonstrate that the result from the experiment coincides with the model predictions. Now, in this case, we have this kind of comparison. So we compare the model and the model predictions with the data, so they appear to agree. But here, we are not doing that, because we are comparing the model prediction, which assumes that humans do not exist, against an observations that are this black line, that is what is really observed. And what is really observed, that of course depends also on humans. Therefore, This is not a comparison, a comparison that is a valid comparison, because if the models are assuming that humans do not exist, to check this prediction, I need an Earth where humans do not exist. Okay? So this is the point, the main point. I need an Earth where the humans do not exist. So if I add a second Earth where there are no humans, everything is equal, but no humans. And in our Earth, we observe a warming. And in the other Earth, without humans, we do not observe any warming, then these predictions would be correct. But we do not have the other Earth without humans. Therefore, we cannot really say that this is a valid comparison. Therefore, this does not say anything. It is possible that the models are wrong. We don't get the right answer because the models are wrong. So this argument does not have any value at all. Now, this problem is actually very understood in the scientific community. Now, you might have heard that 97% of scientists agree about this global warming issue and so on. Indeed, that is not so true because, for example, this is a survey of American Meteorological Society members, and they were asked issues regarding global warming. Of course, everybody agrees that there is a climate change. Okay, everybody can agree on that. Now there is a climate change, but when we talk about the cause of climate change, people don't agree at all. So we have a 30% of people who might agree with the IPCC. And so they might agree that humans are practically responsible of global warming, but then you get about 40% of people that they say that nature is relevant. There is some 20, 30, 40% of natural contribution, and then you have another 15% of people who say that humans and nature contributed more or less 50%, 50-50, and then other people who claims that nature contributed more than humans. So at the end, you have 70% of people who do not really agree with the IPCC claim that practically humans are responsible by 100% of the global warming. So don't be scared about this thing that is actually wrong, completely wrong. So more or less only one third of scientists agree with what the IPCC say. You need to ask the right question, because if you ask the question, did the human contribute to global warming or climate change? Of course, the answer is yes. The models, by looking at the time when humans were not able to influence climate, so we need to look at the past. And actually, what happened in 2000 was the people published this graph, the famous hockey stick graph, and this the purpose of this graph was to demonstrate that climate is stationary, essentially stationary. No, because the models are telling that. The models are telling that climate is stable, okay, it's stationary. And then suddenly it started to rise around 1900, so it started to rise. So you have this hockey stick stuff. So in 2000, so this graph by Mann and colleague was published. Then this was the first picture. The first picture of the climate change 2011, the scientific base of the IPCC. And then number two, the figure number two was this one, was carbon dioxide, methane, and other greenhouse gases. So you see again this hockey stick graph here and here. So the idea was, the message was, look, here we have a hockey stick, here we have a hockey stick, the two things correlated, therefore this warming is anomalous and is due to humans. So this was the beginning of all the alarm. Okay, that it was the beginning, because there was some validation of the models that was claiming that the humans are responsible by 100% of the warming. However, later, this hockey stick was discovered that it was a big illusion. There was errors in how the record has been collected. The IPCC in 2013 publishes this graph with all these spaghetti records, where you see this a lot of variability, a lot of climatic variability that is, does not anymore agree with this picture. So this is one of the pictures. I don't know if you can erase this picture here, if you can take off my image. So what you have here, is that this is one of the reconstructions that are here. Actually, this is this. I think this is the one of these blue lines. So you see here that there is a big cycle. Okay, so you have the Roman warm period, you have a medieval warm period, a Little Ice Age, and the modern warm period, which is not really warmer than the previous warm period. So this picture is completely different from this picture. And of course now you don't have any more the correlation between the anthropogenic forcing and the data. So you lose this connection. Indeed, if we go back in the past, you get a lot of variability, you get a lot of cycles, and you'll get also this warm period during the optimum of the Holocene. So we have this, we know that some of this warm period were much warmer than today, and in particular during the medieval period we have the experience of the Vikings that go to Greenland. So they go to Greenland, they have a village in these lands, they were actually grew barely in South Greenland, so they were these are villages where of the Vikings. What you see here is that there are no trees in these lands. Now it is not possible to live in a place where there are no trees. Okay, so they needed some wood, at least because they needed to repair the ships, so there's a little bit of wood they needed. So the fact that now there are no trees means that now is too cold to have trees, and that at the time of the Vikings this land very likely appeared like this. Here there are some trees. This place is the most southern part of Greenland, where is the only place in Greenland where you still have some trees. But at the time of Vikings, probably also here you had the forest, little forest, but because they needed some wood for growing. We have many evidences of this warm period, the medieval warm period. So for example, now this is from these are Sweden, Norway, Finland. So this is the temperature, the summer temperature, reconstructed in this region. So you see here that the temperature in 2000 is not really different from the medieval period or from the Roman period. So you have exactly the same temperature. So it is hard to believe that this warming from 1900 to now is due only to humans. So how you can claim that this warming from here to here is due to humans? Okay, when you have this kind of pattern, So it's of course you get a cycle, natural cycle, that is very, very important. The mothers are not able to reproduce this natural cycle. Okay, this natural cycle. You have evidence from the Alps. The Alps have, the temperature of the Alps have varied in this way. So now it's more or less here, then the Middle Age was a little bit warmer, in the Roman period was a little bit warmer, and so on. You get a warmer period, warmer and warmer period. So this time was when Hannibal crossed the Alps with the elephants, with the army, so there was not ice, no glacier there, so they could, it could pass. So there were periods where there was very little ice, very little ice in the Alps. So for example, you know this Iceman, it was discovered on the Alps, and this is a mummy. This is a mummy, so that means that there was no ice at all. You need to have a very dry place to have a mummy, okay? To mummify the place. So there was no ice at all, okay? So, and that was this period here, there was no ice at all. So there is the, now under the glaciers in the Alps. Now people are finding trees, so that means that there were forests where today we have glaciers. And so according to this guy, this very important scientist, during the Roman time, the Susten Pass in Switzerland today looks like this, but 2,000 years ago it looked like this, with little wood, little forest around, so you had trees and so on, because here you can find some wood that was there. So there was no ice, a little bit ice on the top, but nothing particular, so it was warmer. Very recently has been discovered this marmot, these animals. It was discovered here at 4,300 meters on Monte Rosa in Italy. It was discovered. So now you have a big glacier. You have the big glacier here. So so of course when this animal died, there was no ice at all, because this animal is actually mummified. So again, there was a dry climate, so there was no ice, no snow, nothing. And it was at 4,300 meters. So now the same place like this. So, so that is where it was found. So it was found this, in the middle of the ice. So again, this is 6,600 years ago, which means that was during these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 here. It was found here, as this time when the ice was very, very low. Okay, so it's a very warm period. So there was this kind of situation. Now, are the mothers able to reproduce the medieval warm period? Are the mothers able to reproduce the medieval warm period? So the mothers, like the one used by the IPCC, are not able to reproduce the warm period of the past. So this is a simulation of these mothers. This is the warm period. As you see, the mothers are not able to reproduce the warm period of the past. What does this means? That the mothers don't have the right mechanism for reproducing the warm period of the past, which means that we need to question this apparent good fitting. Because if the mothers are not able to reproduce the warm period of the past, that means that there are natural mechanisms that are able to reproduce a warming, but the mothers don't have those mechanisms. So it is likely that this apparent fitting during the last 100 years is due to the fact that the mothers are using the greenhouse gases to get the right answer. But that is just a coincidence. Okay, so they have increased the effect of CO2 to get this warming, but it's possible that the modern warm period could have been done by the same mechanism that produced the warm period of the past. And we know this because if we look to this record, so we see that a warm period today, another warm period 1,000 years ago, another warm period 2,000 years ago, another warm period 3,000 years ago, another warm period 4,000 years ago, warm period 5,000, 6,000, 7,000. So it is obvious that there is a 1,000 cycle there, more or less 1,000 cycle. So we need to experience a new warm period. Okay, it's a 1,000 year cycle. So 1,000 ago we get a warm period, 2,000 ago we get a warm period, and now we are getting the warm period for natural reason. But the models don't get any of this warm period, so they don't have the right mechanism. And what is the right mechanism? Now, we will see this is the right mechanism, could be the sun, but I will discuss this later. Now, I would like to discuss another open issue that is regarding this sensitivity of the climate system to CO2. So we need to understand, no? So we would like to validate, to evaluate this good fitting, this apparent good fitting between climate models and the data. And indeed, we need to understand this picture here. So we are talking about the equilibrium climate sensitivity. So this means it's defined as the estimate of the eventual steady state global warming at doubling CO2 concentration in the atmosphere. So we assume to double CO2 concentration, and then we measure the global warming induced by doubling CO2. What is important to say, to know, is that the climate models are not compatible with each other because there are some models like this one who tell us that if we double the amount of CO2 in the atmosphere, the climate will warm by 1.8-1.9 Celsius. And then we have other models like this one that tell us that the climate will warm 5.6 Celsius by doubling CO2. So the climate models are not really compatible with each other, because these models are very different from these models. They are not compatible. It's too big the difference. This is the climate, so this range has increased actually during the year. So instead of reducing the uncertainty, during the years the uncertainty has become bigger and bigger. So we have some models who tell us one story and other models who tell us a completely different story. So when people say that the science is settled, so we understand the climate system, it is completely false. Because our understanding of the climate system is measured by these climate models. If the climate models are completely different from each other, it is not true that we understand the climate system. There are huge uncertainties, okay? So we have this huge uncertainty. Another thing that it's important to notice is that most of the models that show a very high climate sensitivity are from Western countries. So from France, from USA, UK, from Canada. So instead, the models that show a lower climate sensitivity are from also the other countries. For example, these models that show a very low climate sensitivity are from Russia. Then we have some models from China, and then the other models are from Europe and USA. But most of the models that are very, very hot are from Western countries. Now, you know that Western countries are also the most excited about this climate alarmism, right? And you know that the countries like China and Russia are a little bit more moderate. Okay, Russia then they don't care too much, and China also don't care too much. But so this, it is interesting that there is this kind of correlation, because it appears that the climate policy derives from the models that we have. In the Western, we have models, very alarming model, and so there is a lot of alarmism. In other countries, like Russia or China, the models are more moderate, and so the government are more moderate too. So it is very interesting to know this. These things, okay? So there is this kind of script. But the scientific point of view, we need to decide which model to use for the prediction. Because you understand that if the true models, the correct models have a low climate sensitivity, then the CO2 emissions that we can produce in the future will have a small effect on the climate system. So these models will not be alarming. These models instead will be very alarming, because they claim that the climate is very sensitive to CO2 increase. Okay, so we need to decide whether we need to trust this model, or trust this model in the middle, or trust this model that are on the extreme level. Okay, so which model are correct? They are all different. So which model we use for do predictions, okay? Now, the climate sensitivity problem is a very tricky problem, because we have seen that there is a lot of uncertainty, but there are also several studies that are these dots here, several studies who actually claim that climate sensitivity is very, very low, maybe around 1 Celsius. Okay, so this is very, very low, and this is acknowledged by everybody. So you see that there is a discrepancy between the studies. We have evidence from climate modeling favors values of ECS in the upper part of the likely range, whereas many recent studies based on instrumentally recorded warming favor values in the lower part of the range. So we do not only have a huge range, but we have that the models tend to favor high value of the equilibrium climate sensitivity, while many empirical studies show low value of the equilibrium climate sensitivity. So we have a dichotomy. So should we believe the model study or the empirical study? That is very important. And this is actually how the model performed. This is one of my recent study. So here I am comparing the performance of the climate models divided in groups. So I divide the models in 3 groups. We have the low climate sensitivity models, the medium climate sensitivity models, and the high equilibrium climate sensitivity models. So lower than 3 Celsius are the low climate sensitivity models, between 3 and 4.5 are the medium, and above 4.5 Celsius are the high equilibrium climate sensitivity. And these are the yellow area, are the models against the data, that are several different kinds of data. And you see here that the low equilibrium climate sensitivity models are the ones that look to fit the data, while the medium and the high equilibrium climate sensitivity models are the ones that are missing the data. Okay, are the ones that are missing. So practically these models, the high equilibrium climate sensitivity models, are producing too much warming that is not observed during the last 40 years. I am here comparing the data from 1980 to now, okay? And these are the results of this study comparison between the various models. You see that the low equilibrium climate sensitivity models more or less agree with the data. They predict the right warming, okay? While the high, medium, and high equilibrium crank sensitivity models, they produce too much warming. They produce too much warming. That actually, all of them produce too much warming compared with the observations. Then here I put the satellite measurements. I put the satellite measurements that are the measurements from the Spencer record. So you see, the Spencer record is very interesting because it shows very little warming compared to the surface-based records. So if this record is correct, if the real warming is similar to what this record predicts, so you see that practically all climate models, except a few of them, are producing too much warming, So practically, if you believe in the typical records, so you need to exclude the medium and the high equilibrium climate sensitivity models, and accept only the low equilibrium climate sensitivity models. But if you believe in the satellite record, then practically all models are wrong. It cannot be used to do predictions. And exactly, there are many records actually that are showing that the models are running too hot. So the models predict this hot spot on the top of the troposphere, but this hot spot is missing in the observations. So the models are here, the observation here. You see that there is a huge difference. You see huge difference also here. This is the whole troposphere. The models are these red and blue records, while the black lines are the data. You see that the models are producing too much warming during this period. Okay, so you see here, during the last 20 years here, you see models are producing a lot of warming that is not observed in the data. And you can actually continue this analysis. This is still my work. So again, only the low sensitivity models that are these blue lines agree with the data. So this is the low sensitivity models. These are the medium, and these are the high sensitivity models. So actually, you don't get, this is the bias. The real data are here, these green lines are the data, so you see that there is this bias. So it is true that some of the simulation based on the medium and high equilibrium climate sensitivity models may actually fit the data, but we are talking about very few simulations. Okay, so from a statistical point of view, if you have one, two, or three simulations that agree with the data, and you have 200, 300 simulations that don't agree with the data, of course, a few simulations do not matter. So you need to do a statistical analysis. So from a statistical point of view, only the low equilibrium climate sensitivity model may be good enough to predict the future. And okay, there are many studies that show that lower is the climate sensitivity, better are the models. So this is another study that I show. And then there is another study, recent study from this Lewis. Lewis' paper is very interesting because he critiqued the methods used in previous work used by the IPCC. And about the estimate of the climate sensitivity, and he found that those works contain significant errors, inconsistency, other shortcomings. By repeating the calculation in the right way, Lewis found out that the climate sensitivity should be between 1.7 and 2.7 Celsius, so must be low. So again, there are many studies now that show that the climate sensitivity should be low. And okay, there are other, okay, then the study can be improved by demonstrating that the models are wrong also locally. Okay, I will skip this issue. For example, this point is interesting too, because here I show that the climate models actually have problems in interpreting the warming in the ocean and over the land. Practically, the land should warm faster than the ocean, but the climate models do not reproduce correctly the ratio between the warming observed in the land and the warming observed in the ocean. Essentially, the data show that the land should warm more than 2 times faster than the ocean. Okay? The land warms 2 times faster than the ocean. The models show that the land should warm about 1.7 to 1.8 times faster than the ocean. But then there is this black line. This black line is the measurement from the satellites. Satellites tell us that the land warmed 1.5 times more than the ocean. What does this mean? This means that if you believe in the models, then the land is warming too fast relative to the ocean. And this is likely the case because the land record contains a lot of contaminations. For example, this red spot probably are warming of the surface that have nothing to do with the global climate change. No, are cities or other geological phenomena, so heat is coming out from the ground, so it's not really global warming due to atmospheric phenomena, but are phenomena at the surface, so like urban heat islands. We know this because also there are many studies that show that these temperature records are very close to heat sources. Okay, the great majority of the stations are corrupted because they are too close to heat sources. So practically they are recording not the warming of the atmosphere, but they are recording the warming of the streets, of the buildings, and all the other stuff that are built close to this station. Okay? And so he found out, so this is a study from Watts, Anthony Watts, and he found out that 96% of U.S. temperature stations fail to meet what the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration considers to be acceptable uncorrupted placement. So practically all temperature stations have problems, and it is not possible to correct this record. There are other curious issues that are we are observing in the records that are proposed to the public. You see here different kind of the head CRUT records. Well, this is version 3, this is version 4, this is version 5, which is in field version 5. And you see here that during the last 8 years, there has been a strange increase in the rate. So practically in the version 3, the temperature was doing this, and then in the last version, the version 5, the data started to have this strange warming. Now, this is very strange because it appears that they have adjusted the data by changing the homogenization algorithms that are used for correcting the data from biases. Indeed, what they have done probably is to transfer urban heat from the city station to the rural station, so they produce this strange warming that may be fake. Maybe fake because it's not reproduced by other alternative records. So, for example, this is the comparison between the temperature records in this range, in this latitude, over lands, using instruments the blue lines are instruments, and these are three rings. The red line are three rings. So you see that there is a good agreement until 1980. There is a good agreement, and then since 1980 we started to see this huge divergence between the instrumental reconstructions and the three rings reconstructions. So essentially the three are not recording the global climate, global warming. The trees are not able to record that global warming. That is, they record much lower global warming, much lower global warming than instruments. So that is another open issue. So it's possible that the instruments are recording urban heats, yeah. And the satellites agree with these three. The satellites measurements agree with the trees, okay? So there is no this stuff. So there are open issues. So in any case, we have that the only models that we can trust are the low equilibrium climate sensitivity models. And there is the possibility that not even those models may be trusted, because the actual global warming could be lower than what has been reported. The fact is that if we use the low equilibrium climate sensitivity model, the future predictions will be moderate. So if we use the same scenario used by the IPCC, these are the various scenarios, we get that the temperature will increase in the future, but will increase in a moderate way. In a moderate way. That means that it will be difficult to have a temperature above 2 Celsius. So to have problems, to have real problems, you need to have a global warming for above 2 Celsius, no? By 2050. So you need 2-3 Celsius at least to have some real problems, some real issue. But if the low equilibrium climate sensitivity models are used, it will be very difficult to cross that limit, even if we don't do anything. So even if we use the worst scenario, that is this one, so we will perhaps just arrive to 2 Celsius by 2050, but we will not really cross it in a dangerous way. So, but very likely it will be this. So this will be below 2 Celsius, more or less below 2 Celsius from here. So practically, this is below 2 Celsius. So practically, there will be not too much warming in the future. This means that the alarm is low. The alarm is low. Now, I don't have too much time, so I would like to conclude here. So I show you other things, but I will talk about this tomorrow. So let us assume that CO2 is so dangerous. So probably CO2 is not really dangerous for the climate. In any case, it is evident that during the last years, Europe decreased its emissions, but the rest of the world has increased the emissions. So practically nothing happened to the emissions because there was not possibility. Now, this picture is very important for me because this indicates the new coal plants that are being built in the world. So the coal plants are the ones that emit most CO2 than everything else. And you see here that while Europe is not building any coal plant, the rest of the world, in particular in China, in India, in Asia, also in Africa and so on, they are building a lot of coal plants. So this means that even if Europe will not emit any more CO2, very likely nothing will happen because the emissions from the other countries will increase drastically in the next decades, and therefore our sacrifice will be vain, will be completely vain. And so we will destroy our economy, because of course we will use energy, very expensive energy, by thinking that we could save the world. No, if CO2 is really dangerous, as the IPCC claims it to be, the world will not be saved, because the other countries are not doing anything practically. So they are simply ignoring. They are building a lot of coal plants. So this will last for several, for 50, 60, 70 years. So they will continue to build a lot of coal plants. So will be completely useless. In any case, the science of climate change, in my opinion, tell us that the only models that we can trust are the low equilibrium climate sensitivity, which means that the climate is little sensitive to CO2, so it, we can adapt. We can adapt to any climate change that could happen. So is there a climate emergency? Probably not. The equilibrium climate sensitivity is very likely low, probably less than 3 Celsius or even less than 2 Celsius. In fact, alternative climate records suggest that the actual ECS could even be lower than 2 Celsius, which means that it's not worrying at all. Thus, the alarming projected warming for the future decade is not supported by strong evidences, so we should not expect a huge warming in the next decades. This means that we have time to adapt to any climate change that could happen, so we can simply easily adjust to climate change. So we need to adapt. We need to think about adaptation policies, which are less expensive than the mitigation ones and may be efficient, while the mitigation ones will not be efficient because other countries will not do anything, so will practically be. Then I would like to indicate this book that we published in Italian, so the dialogue on climate between emergency and knowledge. So there are several professors that have addressed several topics regarding climate change from a scientific point of view, but also from economical point of view, energetic point of view, and so on. So hopefully one day it will be translated in English so everybody could read it. Okay, so but there is some activity in Italy that we are doing, and so the book has been sponsored by the University of Rome, La Sapienza. So it's a very, in our opinion, it's an important contribution to this debate. Okay, I stop here.
Vielen Dank, Nicolas Graffetta. Okay, nochmal die zwei Fragen und dann geht's weiter.
Thank you very much. I have a question on the slide you showed from the beginning of the stick emergency from emergence from 2000, from the year 2000, and you showed that CO2 followed this hockey stick course, but also methane, metano in Italian. What do you think? What is the reason that the community focused solely on CO2 as a human force and methane?
No, okay, so the climate models assumes all four things, okay, so also methane. But the problem is that methane is a big contribution. So even if it went up, the contribution of methane is very, very little compared to CO2 contribution, okay, because it's 1,000 times, it's 100 times less than CO2 at the end, its effect, so it's very negligible, but it is included in the models, okay, the models use all forcing, CO2 is the most important, but they use all forcing, including also methane forcing.
Okay, vielen Dank.